Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Lower Providence Presbyterian Church on this chilly Sunday morning. For this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Just a few things I want to highlight today. And firstly, if you are in the sanctuary, I want to encourage you to pass your pew pads to sign them and then pass them back through your pews so they can greet one another today. Also, do want to say good morning to those of you that are watching on YouTube. It's great to have you with us today as we worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ on this Sunday morning. I do know that we are having some technical difficulties, so please hang in there with those difficulties, and we're hoping to restore them, but if not, we'll get the service back on our YouTube site for this week so that you can see it later in terms of the recording. But again, thank you for your patience. Well, as I said, I just have a few things to announce, and I do have some exciting news. As you can see, we have a rosebud this morning, and this rosebud represents the birth of Josephine Markley Zollers, who was born on January 26th, and there she is. She's very cute, isn't she? Can I get an amen? And she is the daughter of John Zollers and Bethany Boydum, and the granddaughter of John and Joan Boydum, and Ken and Marianne Zollers, and the great-granddaughter of Jack Boydum. And again, just everybody, please go, ah, so cute indeed, so exciting. You're a great audience, by the way. Thank you so much for humoring me. I really appreciate that. Also do want to mention that next Sunday is our annual congregational meeting, which is Sunday, February 6th. It's going to be at 11:30 a.m. by Zoom invite only. You'll get that Zoom invite in your email box on Friday and then also Sunday morning. In that email, there will also be an attachment for the annual report. And then also, please know, if you want a printed copy of that annual report, you can get it in the narthex today or downstairs in the atrium, or you can get that throughout the week if you'd like to have that in printed form for next Sunday's annual meeting, which is at 11:30 a.m. by Zoom invite only. Also do want to appreciate Wendy Todd and all the work that she does on the annual report. Let's appreciate Wendy, too. Great job, Wendy. It's a wonderful report, too. I already got some positive feedback about the report, which is exciting as well, as we appreciate how this church is so active and how we are a light on the hill for God's kingdom. Can I get an amen? Well, amen to that for sure. Appreciate this church so very much. We also have an exciting activity next Saturday from 3 to 5 p.m. We have our family skate outing at Spring Mountain. They have an outdoor skating rink, which I did not know. So it's going to be a super exciting time for all families, children, and youth. You can still sign up, right, Pastor Kara? That's right. Just email you. Okay, that's way beyond my comprehension, but there is an online form that you can sign as well. Or just send you an email. Kara's like, thanks for that, Ted. That's for sure. But that is next Saturday from 3 to 5. It should be a wonderful time at Spring Mountain. Also have exciting news to mention that our intergenerational mission trip is coming back this summer, July 24th through July 29th, as we are going back to Western North Carolina to repair homes, to do food pantry support, and other church activities in which service takes place. We are really going to lean into our new mission and vision as an intergenerational church as we aspire to serve Jesus Christ by being his hands and feet to those that are in need in Western North Carolina. And by the way, we are going to be in the midst of the Appalachian Mountains, which are incredibly beautiful. Please know that if you're interested and you have questions, you can email me. If you want to sign up, please email me as well. And that sign-up due date is March 27th. But registration and payment is not due until the end of May. It is a wonderful trip. It is simply life-changing. We love to have a big group this year, so I encourage you to really think about it. And again, if you have questions, please email me here at the church, or you can call me through the church office as well. At this time, let us now stand and greet one another in the name of Jesus Christ. I'd like to invite Janet Azar to come forward for a minute. for mission. Oh, Janet, let me get that.
Good morning, everyone. Can you all hear me? Oh, good. I haven't lost it then. Okay. First of all, prayer shawl ministry started in about 1998 by a woman, two women actually, Janet Severy Bristow and Victoria Gallo. They were graduates of a seminary in Hartford, Connecticut. It has evolved to what we are doing now. And I'd like to just give you a little history. As a high school teacher, I'm sure if you are a teacher, you probably don't have as much time to do all those fun things that you always like to do. Well, Joan Boynum and I felt that way when we were teaching in Methacton. And we decided that we would get together once a month and do stuff, whatever we wanted to do. And it evolved to getting other people involved, and to tell you the truth, it is still going strong. We have about 10 to 12 people regularly, always different, sometimes the same people. It doesn't matter. Everybody gets together. And the prayer shawls evolved from that group. And when you didn't have something to do, we said, well, you can always do a prayer shawl, because we always have stuff, you know, and anybody that does crafting or sewing or anything like that, you always have fabric left over and so forth. Prayer shawls don't have to be just knitted and crocheted. If you look to the right, there's a beautiful quilt that is designated for someone that Pat Grant made. She is an excellent seamstress. And you can see that, like I said, that is not everything that our group does. Janice Lynch, years ago, did start the prayer shawl ministry, and we did have a thing where we taught people a couple of times to knit or crochet. Anyone can participate, and if you know someone in your circle of friends or family that could use one, you are certainly able to take one. The only thing we ask is that you just sign for it so we know where they are going, and they are kept in Judy Baker's office. Every prayer shawl has a tiny little cross on one of the edges. There's not a standard to where they go, but on every single one of the edges. And what happens is that they get a beautiful prayer that goes with it. One of them that we have sent out, this shawl was made just for you to bring comfort, to know you are loved, to share your joy. This shawl is to wrap you when you're cold, when you're hurting, when you need to snuggle. This shawl was knitted or crocheted with blessings, with love and prayers. And it was signed by Lower Providence Presbyterian Church. There is another prayer. I have a feeling that these shawls are all over the world, and that there are many others. In fact, I'm going to end this by, if you would bow your heads and think of someone that in your family or in your life somewhere that might use a prayer shawl, just pretend that you are giving them one, and it might say something like this: May God's grace be upon this shawl, warming, comforting, enfolding, and embracing. May this mantle be a safe haven as a sacred place of security and well-being, sustaining and embracing in good times, as well as difficult ones. May the one who receives this shawl be cradled in hope, kept in joy, graced in peace, and wrapped in love. Blessed be. Okay, and if anyone is interested in joining our stitchery group, you can contact me or you can contact Joan Boydum, and we would be more than happy to have you. We meet in our houses, but if we are considering trying to start one here at the church, maybe once a month, and if you need to be taught something. And by the way, I wasn't just talking to the women, I'm talking to you guys. All right, how many of you men remember Rosie Grier? Okay, what did he do? He was a football player, a very good one. Do you know in his spare time he was an avid needle pointer? and did absolutely beautiful needlepoint. And I know two people in my life, two gentlemen that love to stitch. One does counted cross stitch, and the other one did an array of things when he retired, and he happened to break his leg and driving his wife nuts, as that is, could be very familiar to a lot of you, okay? Anyway, look for the Hilltop highlights, because we will be putting more information about that. If you have any questions, I'm in the directory. Please don't hesitate to call or call Joan Boydham. Thank you.
Thank you, Janet, for that wonderful ministry that certainly makes a difference in people's lives as they go through difficult times, to know that others are praying for them and supporting them with this beautiful gift of a prayer shawl. At this time, let us now prepare our hearts to worship the living and triune God.
Thank you.
stand and join me in the call to worship? The Lord is our shepherd. With you all our needs are met. We do not need to be afraid, for you are with us. Let us worship the Lord, our shepherd, who never leaves us nor forsakes us. Please remain standing as we sing hymn number 306, Fairest Lord Jesus. Please be seated. Let us pray. Sovereign God, we come before you with humble hearts and relying in your word that sustains us. As the psalmist declared in Psalm 46, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging, the Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Lord, we continue to live in challenging times, and yet you are our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Almighty God, you are with us, and that gives us great hope for today, tomorrow, and all days. Emmanuel, we think of our world today, and we pray for your presence of peace and comfort to be upon those who are oppressed, impoverished, grieving, ill, and all who are hurting and struggling, whatever the reasons might be. Compassionate God, we also think of those in our congregation and those close to our hearts who are sick, grieving, or struggling for any reason, and we lift them up to you in silent prayer. Loving God, help us to be your hands and feet of care and compassion to all people. And we pray that your light and love might flow from us in our words and deeds, so that all people will know that this church on the hill is a caring church. God of grace, we come today admitting that we don't always get it right, as we are in need of your forgiveness. Lord, we fall short of your glory with our words and deeds that don't promote loving you or loving our neighbor. Lord, please forgive us for our sinful outward actions and sinful inward thoughts that are not pleasing to you, and we confess our sins to you in silent prayer. Lord, we thank you that you forgive us as far as the east is from the west, and that you remember our sins no more. Shepherd God, we are reminded today through the parable of the lost sheep that you love us so much that when we wander, you seek us out till we are found. And Lord, we thank you for your unconditional love and grace that reminds us that we are loved whether we are lost or found. Gracious God, help us to lean into your loving arms, to know that we are the sheep of your flock, in which you will always be there for us, even when we stray. And so, Lord, we come to you as our shepherd, who knows every hair on our head and who knows us by name, as we pray the words that your Son, Jesus Christ, has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God's word says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us of our sins, and purify us from all unrighteousness. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Well, hey, kids and adults, too. It's time for the children's sermon. And here's Mary Ann. The two.
Good morning, friends. It's so nice to see you this morning. Well, I'm here with Gus and Violet, and we were supposed to have one more friend with us today, but I'm not sure where she is. Gus, Violet, do you know where Sparkle Twinkle Toes is? I wanted to introduce her to the kids. No? No, you don't know where she is? You have no idea. You definitely didn't send her off to get lost somewhere because you were jealous of how sparkly she is? Oh, you did you? Oh my goodness. This is an emergency. Call the police. Call the fire department. Call the army. You think I'm overreacting? No, guys, this is really important. Sparkle Twinkle Toes' mom says that she has a terrible sense of direction and that I better keep a really close eye on her. I better go look for her. I should make a drip, drip, drip that'll never stop. Whoa. I should that'll tip, tip, tip till you just don't bash. Phew! I finally found her. Friends, this is Sparkle Twinkle Toes. I'm so happy we found her, aren't you? I should call the president, or the Queen of England, or Mickey Mouse. Our new friend is safe and sound. Now that you're here, my sparkly friend, we can get on with the children's sermon. Gus and Violet were having a little bit of trouble understanding why one missing owl was such a big deal. That reminds me of some parables that Jesus told. One about a missing sheep, and one about a missing coin. Do you all remember that parables are stories that Jesus told that each have an important lesson? Let's listen to the parables together. The Lost Sheep and the Lost Coin. Telling stories was Jesus' favorite way to teach about God. Once there was a shepherd who had 100 sheep, Jesus said. He loved them all. The big ones and the little ones, the good ones and the naughty ones. They were his sheep, and he loved them. Every day, this shepherd counted his sheep to make sure they were all safe. One day, he counted only 99 sheep. Oh no! One was missing. Right away, the shepherd left the 99 sheep together and went to look for the one that was lost. The shepherd listened for the lost sheep to baa. He looked in all the places that sheep might get stuck or in trouble. It took a while, but the shepherd kept looking until he found the missing one. Then he called to all his friends and neighbors. "Come on over," he cried. "I found my sheep. Let's have a party." Jesus loved telling people stories like this about something being lost and then found. "I have another story," Jesus said. "Once there was a woman who saved up 10 little silver coins. One day she was counting them and discovered that she had lost one. What do you think she did? Did she think to herself, 'Oh well, I've still got 9, so who cares if one is lost?' No, she did not. She lit her lamp and swept the house from top to bottom. She looked under and over and around everything in her house until she found her lost coin. Oh, she was so happy she had a party to celebrate. God is like this shepherd and this woman, you know," Jesus said. "God would never stop looking for someone who was lost."
"You see, Gus and Violet, I had to go looking for Sparkle Twinkle Toes because she was lost, and then I celebrated when I found her. In the stories Jesus told, the shepherd went to look for the lost sheep, and the woman went to look for the lost coin. These parables help us understand that God's big, bright, never-ending love is reaching out to all people everywhere. God wants to save those who are lost. I'm so glad that God loves people enough that He is always looking for them. So, what did you guys learn today?
The shepherd looked for the lost sheep, and the woman looked for the lost coin. God loves all His children. He's always searching for the ones who are lost. And Miss Marianne loves all her owls.
Yes, that's right. Very good job. Now, let's pray together. Bow your heads, friends. Dear God, thank you for loving us. And thank you that the story of the lost sheep and the lost coin remind us of how special each one of us is to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Bye, friends.
Bye, friends.
Bye, friends.
Bye, friends.
I love when the owls bow their heads. I don't know if you noticed that or not. Oh, so cute. We certainly appreciate Marianne and the wonderful children's sermons that she gives us. Amen. Please remember the words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who said this: "It is much more blessed to give than to receive." Let us now give of our tithes and our offerings. And I think I forgot the Gloria Patri. I don't normally do the liturgist part, so I forgot that. So please stand as we sing first. For the offering now, since I've already done that. And let us now enjoy the bell choir for the offertory anthem as we give of our tithes and our offerings.
may be seated. I want to thank Janet today for a wonderful minute to mission with the history of the prayer shawl ministry. Prayer shawls are flying out of my office like hotcakes. It's a wonderful, wonderful ministry to celebrate here at Lower Providence Presbyterian Church. And we give thanks for the opportunity out of love and out of concern for our Christian brothers and sisters that we know and many we don't know. We've seen answers to prayer. We've sent out of town. We've given to those we know and don't know. And it's a tangible gift to those who are in need, who are suffering. So what makes a prayer shawl different from any other shawl or a quilt? It's a simple repeating of the pattern and the prayers that are prayed over the shawl or quilt as it is being made. Praying to the triune God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The positive thoughts and prayers poured into every stitch truly make each piece a unique comfort. While we know that God is always present in our lives and that His love transcends all tragedy, illness, and pain, we also know that sometimes a physical reminder can bring hope and healing and peace to someone who is crying out. We pray over these shawls, and pray these shawls bring comfort to those who receive them. Let us be in prayer. God of creation, redemption, and sustaining grace, we praise you for the opportunity to take part of the ministry so that we might see a world beyond ours. Blessed are the works of your hands. Without even knowing who would receive it, this shawl was made specifically for the person who will receive it. May your creations bring love, support, and comfort in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. May they see the intricate love and care given to this shawl, mirroring the intricate love and care that God bestows upon all people. This shawl was made to bring warmth to someone who feels a chill, needs to be wrapped in your healing arms. May they feel the warmth, breath of the Holy Spirit as they wrap themselves with it. The shawl was made to bring comfort to someone who feels alone. May they feel comfort in knowing that someone prayed for them as they pieced it together. This shawl or quilt was made to bring peace to someone in need of prayer. May they feel the power of our prayers as they feel the yarn winding through their fingers. This shawl was made to remind the recipient that they are part of this community, this body of Christ. May they feel touched by our love, moved by our guidance, and held up by our support. We thank you for putting those in need on our hearts and minds so that we may fully live out your call to love and serve. We ask that you bless these shawls and quilts and the loving hands that have created the shawls. May your light shine in them and be a beacon of the hope that is promised to all of us. May the power of the Holy Spirit live and breathe within each of us through these shawls and quilts and through the lives that they will touch. Shower us all with your loving grace, O God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Judy. Please stand for our next hymn, hymn number 387, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us.
Thank you. morning. I'm happy you all made it out today. I wasn't sure if we'd have a crowd because, my goodness, I did not really want to come to church this morning in the cold. Sorry, Ted. I know. I'm just being honest with you all. Well, today we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 10. And I'm going to give you a little bit of background before we read the text together. At this point in Luke, Jesus, along with his disciples, are making their way to Jerusalem, which when he gets there, we know he will be tried and crucified. Along this journey, Jesus reveals the makeup of his kingdom community. And he reveals this through encounters he has with people along the way, people like tax collectors and sinners, like Samaritans and Gentiles. While the religious leaders of that time, like the Pharisees, begin to see who Jesus is associating with, and they're not happy about it. So Jesus responds to their complaints with three parables all about lost things being found. Today we're going to look at two of those three parables. So let's read together Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 10. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be uplifting to you, our strength, our rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. I'm sure we can all relate to the story of losing something valuable, searching with anxiety and worry, and then rejoicing with gladness when that thing is found. Maybe these two parables triggered a story in your mind of when you lost something like your keys, a credit card, a wallet, a wedding ring, or maybe you thought about a time when you got lost or one of your children got lost. Well, I immediately thought of a story from college. It was my freshman year, and I was given, like every other freshman, an ID card that was essential to your existence on campus. It got you food in the cafeteria, coffee at the campus coffee shop. It got you to check out a book. You use your card. It allowed you to get in and out of buildings. And because I went to a Christian school, it also kept track of the amount of chapels I attended. Now, you only get one card for all 4 years. So if you lose it, you have to purchase another one for an unreasonable price, like $20, which for a college student is a lot of money, okay? Well, one day, only a few months into my freshman year, I realize my card is missing. So I frantically recruit my roommates to help me look, and we look everywhere. We look all over my room. We look in my pockets, my purse, my backpack. We check the dorm bathroom, the kitchen, the lounge. And just as we were about to give up, I realized the last time I had used my card was in the cafeteria. I put it on a tray and I was sure I had thrown it out. And so I wasn't about to give up. I then convinced my roommates that we were going to go to the cafeteria and look through the garbage. So we went, my friends somewhat begrudgingly and me thinking about the $20 I was about to save. We looked through the garbage bag and we looked through the garbage bag some more. And after digging through food scraps for God knows how long, we did not find my card. Completely defeated and smelling like garbage, we went back to the dorm, took showers, got changed, and got ready for bed. I climbed onto the top bunk and exhausted, rolled over to close my eyes. And guess what I found? Right there in plain sight, sitting on top of my comforter, was my ID card. I rejoiced with gladness and looked over to my roommates, showing them what I found. And let's just put it this way, they were not so happy with me. Clearly, the good news of my found ID card was not so good news for my roommates. Our responses were different because the value of that ID card for me was not the same as it was for them. Well, today, as we look at these two parables about lost and found things, we're going to see that in the same way, these stories elicit different meanings and even responses for their listeners. Now, the context of these parables reveal that there are three different audiences Jesus was addressing with these parables. The first were the sinners and the tax collectors sitting around Jesus at that table. The second were the disciples who had been traveling with Jesus and were being trained in how to live out his mission in the world. And the third were the Pharisees, questioning why Jesus would be spending time with such a sinful group. So today we're going to try and hear this parable through the eyes of each of these audiences. And hopefully we will come to understand how profound Jesus' words were to them and today to us. So first, the tax collectors and sinners. Tax collectors at that time were considered traitors and thieves. They were Jewish people who worked for Rome collecting taxes. But they often took beyond what was needed from Rome so that they could pocket it themselves. They lived in wealth right alongside the Jewish community who they stole from and who many could not put food on the table. Because of this, they were despised by the Jewish community. Their very own families would often disown them. And worse than that, if they were to go to the synagogue and wanted to tithe, the church would not even take their money. Then there's the more broad description of sinners. Who were these sinners Jesus was spending time with? Well, considering the past stories of Jesus, we know he hung out with prostitutes, with Samaritans who were enemies of the Jews, Gentiles who worshiped other gods, outsiders, drunkards, and criminals. Tax collectors and sinners were considered outsiders for good reason. They had committed wrongs, often wrongs that not only hurt themselves, but the people around them. In other words, they had lost their way in life. So Jesus looks at this group of lost people and tells the story of a shepherd who values every sheep he owns enough to leave his flock of 99 to find the lost one. What's interesting to see here is that 100 sheep would mean this shepherd was pretty wealthy at that time. He didn't have to leave the flock to find that lost sheep. He could have hired someone to go out and look for the sheep while he stayed home, or he could have just left it behind. But that's not what this shepherd does. He leaves the 99 to go find the one. This shows great intentionality, concern, and care from the shepherd. This shows how much the shepherd valued each and every one of his sheep. The shepherd put his own life at risk, walking across rugged and dangerous terrain where wild animals roamed, to find his one lost sheep and bring it home. And then Jesus goes on to tell the story of a woman who lost a coin. We don't know much about this woman. Most likely she's single or widowed because there is no mention of a husband. This puts her at a great disadvantage in a patriarchal society, which is probably why she's also poor. 10 coins is not a whole lot in first century Palestine, so one coin has great value. A lost coin could have left her in a position where she couldn't eat that week. And so she searches her whole house, she lights a lamp, she looks in every dark corner and crevice under every piece of furniture until she finds it and returns it to the other coins, saving it. What do these communicate to the sinners of the and the lost sitting around the table with Jesus? Well, it communicates good news, life-changing news, amazing news. Many call chapter 15 of Luke the gospel in the gospel, as it contains the essence of the good news which Jesus came to tell. Just like the shepherd values his lost sheep and the woman values her lost coin, so too does God value, love, and search for those who have lost their way from him. You see, this kind of love means that God does not see these tax collectors and sinners for the worst thing they've ever done, like the rest of society does. Beyond their mistakes and blunder, God sees these people for the beautiful creation he made them to be in the first place. And so, like a father or mother who urgently and without ceasing looks for a lost child, God will not give up on his pursuit of those who have lost their way until every one of his flock is found and brought back to him. This is the very reason God came to us as the person of Jesus. God is not one to distance himself, waiting for us to get our lives perfected before we come to him. Motivated by his love for us, God is the pursuer in the relationship. And he will never relent in his pursuit of us. As Paul states in Romans 8:38, this is actually one of my favorite verses, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. God will go to the farthest and the darkest places of our souls to bring us back into his loving presence. Church, nothing can separate us from God's love, not even the worst thing we've ever done. As I was reading this story, preparing for this sermon, God put on my heart very strongly the parents of our congregation, particularly parents who feel as though their child right now is lost. I know there are some of you watching your child make self-destructive decisions. You're worrying about where they are sleeping tonight and what they're doing with their life. Maybe they have an addiction they can't overcome. Maybe they're making choices that could get them into trouble and with the law. Maybe they're in a harmful relationship that they just keep going back to. Or maybe you're a parent who raised your child in the church. Your child believed in God at one point, but they've walked away from God in anger because something the church did has hurt them deeply. And so they passionately argue against God rather than seek God. I want you to know that no matter how far away your child seems to have strayed, God is there. God is pursuing your child, and he won't relent, he won't give up, he won't leave anyone behind until his entire flock is found. Bob Goff, in his book Love Does, states this: "I used to think there were some prisons you couldn't escape, but now I know there's no place I can go where God can't rescue us." Now, the second group that Jesus was addressing were the disciples, Jesus' 12 closest companions. Remember, I told you at the beginning of the sermon that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, where he would eventually be tried and crucified. Well, Jesus takes the opportunity to use this journey with his disciples to train them in their calling as his followers under his new kingdom. So the disciples are literally learning as they go. It sounds a lot like our own faith journeys, right? As they travel together, Jesus teaches them about the cost of discipleship, the challenges they'll face, and the importance of their role in bringing forth his message. Jesus also shows the disciples who belongs to the kingdom, which here we see include tax collectors and sinners, the outsiders of society. Everything Jesus did and taught along their journey, the disciples were learning from. And so as Jesus shares these two parables with the tax collectors and the sinners, he is also sharing these parables with the disciples as a teaching tool. So what kind of message is this for the disciples? This message is the message of calling and sending. A message that calls the disciples to go and do likewise. Seek out the lost, just as the shepherd sought out the sheep and the woman the coin. Just as Jesus has pursued and found the lost people of their society, so too are the disciples to do the same. You see, upon Jesus' resurrection, he would commission these 12 to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. He would empower them with the Holy Spirit to be his hands and feet in the world, to be his vessels of love to the lost. And so this parable is summarizing the mission the disciples are to follow. He's giving the disciples a vision for the purpose of God's people in the world. And just as he commissions the disciples with this story, he too also sends us, the church, to go and seek out the lost. Church, we as a faith community aren't supposed to merely tend to the flock around us. We don't merely exist for ourselves and our needs. We shouldn't be content with the 9 saved around us. We're to be a people that are focused outward, a people who are not restricted by the walls of our building, but go out to seek the lost and bring them into the fold of Christ's community. If we truly believe the message of Jesus is good news, we should do this like the shepherd and the woman, with haste, with urgency, with perseverance. Because if these parables tell us anything about the mission, the lost won't find us. The model of build it and they will come is not Jesus' model of ministry. We must go to them just as Jesus has come to us. One ministry group that gets this outward mission so well is the Ministry of Young Life, which we actually support here in the Methacton School District. Both Ted and I were Young Life leaders in college. If you don't know what it is, Young Life is a ministry to high schoolers that goes into schools, meets kids where they are at, and invites them to know Jesus. I always said it was the hardest ministry I have ever done because it was so incredibly uncomfortable. The kids thought I was weird for wanting to hang out with them. They didn't get why I was showing up at football games and volunteering at band concerts. But eventually, when I went to camp, many of these kids heard the message of Jesus for the first time, and their life changed. God found them, and they found God. And so what did we do as leaders? We rejoiced. Just like the shepherd and the woman gathered their friends around them to rejoice, we celebrated each and every one of these students. On the last night of camp, each kid would come up and share their name if they've committed their life to Christ. And every leader in that room cheered loudly and celebrated with joy. That last night was a party, a celebration. The work was worth it. So I want us to ask ourselves, when was the last time we as a church have rejoiced over someone who was lost finding Jesus? If we are truly living out Jesus' mission, shouldn't we be celebrating all the time? This leads to the third group that Jesus was addressing, the Pharisees, a religious sect of that time. Now, Pharisees get a bad rap in the Bible. They're cast as the opponents to Jesus throughout the Gospels. They question his actions and his followers. However, I think what we lose in the text is the fact that the Pharisees' underlying intentions were actually really good. They were a devout group who took their faith very seriously. They were trying to preserve Judaism and their identity as God's people. Believing God's promise that the Jewish nation was to be a light to the world, they strived to remain pure from the surrounding world by keeping the law in every way they possibly could. Nevertheless, they took this way too far. You see, the problem came when they began to value their traditions and rituals to the point that they lost sight of the people that they were supposed to be a light to. They lost sight of their purpose and their mission. Doesn't sound like today's church at all, right? To remain pure and set apart from the rest of the world, the Pharisees didn't allow themselves to eat with, associate with, or even have business dealings with those who didn't follow the law. Their focus was caring for the flock. This is why Jesus' actions of sitting around a table with tax collectors and sinners was so disturbing to them. If Jesus was claiming to be a religious leader or even the Messiah they had all been waiting for, why would he be surrounding himself with people who were far from following God's way? You are who you surround yourself with, right? Think about the way we judge others based on who they surround themselves with today. The Pharisees were doing just the same. And so along with the sinners and the tax collectors, Jesus tells the Pharisees these two parables. I picture them grumbling as Jesus described the shepherd finding his lost sheep and rejoicing, not getting it until Jesus looks at them and says, "I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent." So what kind of news are these two parables communicating to the Pharisees? Well, it's challenging news for them. Jesus was challenging their way of faith. He was showing them that they have forgotten their purpose as a light to the world. He was making it clear that their focus on maintaining traditions and rituals had caused them to be so inward focused, they've lost sight of their outward mission. Jesus' words hopefully made them wonder about the last time they'd actually rejoiced over the work of God. Or were they merely rejoicing over their own works? And just like Jesus' words challenged the Pharisees, they should challenge us today. As I asked before, when was the last time we as a church rejoiced over a lost person coming to know Jesus? When was the last time we've truly thought about how our church reaches people beyond our walls? Have we been more worried about maintaining and feeding our flock and lost sight of the world we're supposed to be reaching? Are we so focused on our rituals and our traditions that we've forgotten our mission to the world? Are we merely managing what was lost to the neglect of what's still been lost? Many ask why we came up with a new mission and vision for our church. Well, to some extent, we hope it keeps us from becoming like the Pharisees. The reality is, just because we're in the church and have the best intentions doesn't mean we don't also wander away from God's way. If Jesus were to sit at a table with no sinners, we know he'd be sitting by himself. And so it's easy for us as a church to start with the best intentions like the Pharisees, and then along the way forget our purpose, to forget what we are called to. And so our mission and vision reminds us of why we exist as a church. It keeps us focused on the mission of God, the mission that God called the disciples to, and the mission that God calls us to. It reminds us that we're not just about maintaining the flock, but about serving the world. We're about seeking Jesus together and shining his light from this hill. We're about welcoming the lost into our community, inviting them into a growing relationship with Jesus, and encouraging them to live out this relationship through serving. And our hope is that there will be a whole lot of celebrating happening in this community as we refocus around our mission and vision. So who are you in this story? Are you the sinner and tax collector who needs to hear the good news of God's love? Are you the disciple feeling commissioned to go and seek out the lost? Are you the Pharisees who are having the best intentions lost sight of the mission? Church, no matter who you are, the parable is good news for you. God loves you and he pursues you. God empowers you to do likewise. And God gives you a renewed vision when you forget. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Now let us stand and proclaim what it is we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please stay standing as we sing our final song about the reckless love of God.
So good to me. so kind to me.
Love never leaves us nor forsakes us. God is the pursuer in this relationship, and he will never give up on his pursuit of us. And let's never give up on sharing that pursuit with the world. Now for your blessing. Now may the blessings of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all until we meet again in this place or forevermore. Amen. And amen.